polymer has to pass through, that is, the molten polymer has to pass through different elements. So finally, we are producing the continuous filament, continuous filaments. Okay, now, so here is, this is the line diagram of melt spinning line. So if you carefully observe this melt spinning line, first I'll just try to figure it out, what are the different elements. Then I'll tell you, explain you what is the function of each and every element is. Now this is, this we call it as hopper or feed element, and this is nothing but extruders, and this is nothing but, here the name is not given, but this is nothing but manifold, and this is nothing but gear pump. This is the gear pump. Okay, this is the filter pack, this is the spinneret, and this is the quenching chamber, or we can also call it as cooling chamber. Okay, and this is the lubrication system, or we can also call it as the temporary finish, that is spin finish application, this one. And this is the, these are the drawing rollers, and finally this is the bobbin, that is where the yarn will wind onto the bobbins by friction driven mechanism. Okay, so this is how, this is what the different elements which are present in the melt spinning line. So right from hopper, extruder, manifold, gearing pump, filter pack, spinneret, quenching chamber or cooling chamber, spin finish application, and then drawing rollers, and finally wind it on to bobbins. So these are the different elements. So if you look at the function of, or the passes of the polymer through different elements, it will flow in this way. Now you see polymer chips, first we are feeding to hopper, this is what the hopper is, and then it is subjected to extruder, and then gear pump, filtration, spinneret, quenching, spin finish application, drawing, and then winding. So likewise, where the polymer is going through the different elements. Okay, now I will explain you. So what is the function of each and every element in this melt spinning line? Okay, so if you look at this hopper, I told you this is hopper, where we are feeding the polymer chips. As I told you already, in case of polyester and nylon, where the polymerization process, which leads to a liquid or molten polymer only. So that molten polymer directly we can feed to extruders. So otherwise, if you are having a solid polymer at the end of the polymerization, what we have to do is, we have to crush the polymer into small chips. First, we have to wash it thoroughly, and then we have to dry it, and then we have to crush into small chips. And those chips we are feeding to the hopper. Like this. These are the polymer chips. Okay. And from the hopper, all the polymeric chips are coming to this extruder. Okay. So the important function of the extruder is, inside the extruder, you can see there is a screw kind of thing. It's a rod, and these are the screws. So which, this inside the screw, which is heated, that is the screw is heated inside. Now, depending upon the melting point of polymer, where we are maintaining the temperature inside the screw. Now these are all the heating elements. These are all the heating elements. Okay. Now, whenever the polymeric chips come and contacts the outside surface of the screw, what will happen? Where the polymer chip starts to melt. So, since the screw is rotating, what it happens is, this will take all the polymeric chips forward. So, finally, when it comes to the end of the extruder, all the polymeric chips, it will get melted. It will get melted in the extruder. So, the important function of this extruder is to melt the polymer, to melt the polymer chips. This is an important function of this extruder. Once the polymer is melted, then that polymer is transported through this manifold. Through this manifold, where this molten polymer is distributed through different spinning lines. Okay, in the spinning lines, you can see after the manifold where we have a gearing pump. So, if you look at the construction of the pumper, it is going to be like this, where it consists of a gears. Now, what will happen is, so this from the manifold, we are getting the molten solution, like this. And whenever this gearing pump gears are rotated, what will happen between the gears? We have the gaps. So through this gap, uniformly, the molten solution will come out and then it will reach the filter pack. Here is the filter pack. Okay, so it consists of sand and some other particles. So what it will do is, if at all any unmolten particles or if at all any impurities are there in the molten polymer, where that can be filtered it out. Otherwise, what will happen? If at all any unmolten polymers, polymer chips, and then any dust and impurities are there, so where that may come along with the filaments, which gives or which will affect the quality of the filament. So that's why what we are doing, we are filtering out all the impurities here, and then we are taking the molten polymer to the spinneret. So the cross section of the spinneret is like this. These are the holes which are there in the spinneret. So whenever we are forcing the polymer inside the spinneret, you can see the filaments will come out from the holes like this. Just like a shower is there, if you are passing the water at some pressure, like in third floor or fourth floor, we are having the water tank. So from the tank, always the water will come at some force, at some pressure, it will come out through the spray, okay, that is a shower. Through that nozzles, the water will come out. The same way, the filaments also will come out through the spinneret. Now you see, these are all the filaments. Okay, now, what do you think, whether these filaments are just coming out from the spinneret, where still it is in its liquid state only? So do you think, can you take out all the filaments and immediately winding onto some rollers or any other bobbin? Do you think we can wind it directly as such? No. Why? Because still the filament is in its liquid state only. So what we have to do to wind it onto rollers, we have to make the liquid form of filament into solid form. So here it is, liquid form. That means still the filaments are in its sticky, that is molten state. So in order to make the filaments solid, okay, where what we are doing is, we are doing this, we are passing the filaments through this quench chamber or quenching chamber. So what we are doing is we are passing the cool air. So soon after the filaments that are coming out from the spinneret, we are passing the cool air. Now what will happen? The liquid state of the filaments are not liquid state, the molten state we can say. The molten state of filaments. So when it subjects to this cool air, it will get solidify. That means it becomes to its solid state. So what we did, initially the polymer is in solid state. We have melted it in the extruder and then we have produced the filaments through spinneret. And after production of filaments, again we are converting that filament into its solid state. Once the filament reaches to its solid state by means of the quenching process, then the filament is subjected to, that is, the spin finish application, then it is stretched in between the two draw rollers, and then finally it is winding onto bobbins. Understand? So this is how we are producing continuous length of filaments by using this melt spinning line. And these are all the various elements. What are those elements? Where we have the polymeric chips, there is a hopper, there is a hopper, and there is an extruder, there is a manifold which distributes the molten polymer solution for the different spinning lines, and then gear pump, filter pack, spinneret, and then quenching chamber, spin finish application, and then drawing, and finally winding on to bobbins. So these are all the different elements and the function of each and every element okay. Now we will see in detail about what is each and every element, like how the extruder looks like and how the polymer will melt in different stages in extruder. Okay, before going to that, now you are seeing the industrial melt spinning line, the industrial scale melt spinning line. Now you can see clearly, this is a hopper you are feeding, and this part is extruder, and then filter, and then it comes to spinning head where we have this gear pump and filter pack, everything is there, and finally we have the filaments. This is a spinneret. We have filaments that are coming out, and we are applying spin finish here, and then it has been winding onto bobbins. And here the drawing rollers are not shown, so in here you can see we are imparting even drawing holes, and then we are winding onto bobbins. So this is how the industrial scale melt spinning line looks like. Okay, now if you see this, whatever the thing which I explained you, like whatever the granules or whatever the polymeric chips that are there, which is nothing but the starting material for this melt spinning process. And whatever the starting material, that is polymeric chips, are there. So before getting that polymeric chips, that has to be washed and dried, and we need to maintain as low as possible moisture in it, and then we have to take it, and then we have to extrude it through extruder, that is we have to melt it, and then we have to maintain the homogeneity, that is proper mixing of the molten solution. Without mixing, if you pump as such through the spinneret, you cannot expect the right quality in the final filament. So we have to maintain that homogeneity in the polymer melt, then we have to produce continuous filaments, and then we have to wind it onto bobbins. Okay, so this is how in melt spinning line the filament is produced. And if you look at the spinning speeds, so whenever you are going through a process or you are going through a machine, you should know what is the speeds of the spinning machines. Like in solution spinning we have seen, is it right? In dry spinning, so maximum we can go up to 1000 or 1500 meters per minute. When it comes to wet spinning, where it is limited to 300 to 500 meters per minute because of the solvent removal, everything is there. Okay, when it comes to the conventional spinning process, where the spinning process have been carried out at 600 to 150 meters, 1500 meters per minute, and the spun yarn is drawn at 400 to 1000 meters per minute at a draw ratio between 3 and 4.5. So the spinning speeds at conventional spin, like the earlier days, whatever the mill spinning speeds are there, it is around 600 to 1500 meters per minute. In a minute, we can get this many meters. Once the filaments have been produced, it has to be drawn to impart orientation, everything. Understand? That is the drawing process. Where the drawing has been carried out at 400 to 1000 meters per minute at a draw ratio of between 3 to 4. What do you mean by draw ratio? For example, you are taking a filament which is of 1 centimeter length. 1 centimeter length. So, if you are claiming that a draw ratio of 3 in the sense, you are extending this filament up to 3 centimeters. So now we call it as a draw ratio of, this is the draw ratio of 3. Suppose if you are extending the filament up to 4.5 centimeter, then the draw ratio is 4.5. Understand? So the drawing is carried out at 400 to 1000 meters per minute by maintaining a draw ratio of 3 to 4.5. So whatever the filament you are getting, you are extending the filament up to 3 times or 4.5 times. So that all the molecules inside the polymer, it will align in a orderly, that is into the yarn or filament axis. Okay. Into the filament axis. Okay. Now, when it comes to direct spin draw process, okay, so direct spinning and drawing. So this means spinning and drawing in one continuous operation. That means here in conventional spinning we are doing, after spinning we are drawing at this much speeds. But in direct spin draw process, spinning and drawing will happen at a continuous operation. Ultimately, winding speeds may be as high as 6000 meters per minute. You see, so what extent the spinning speeds are increased, that is 600 meters per minute, but the spinning speed is unlike to extend in a practical scenarios where if you cannot go at 4000. So if you can go up to 6000, but the problem is the end breakages and all. So to prevent all those things, that is end breakages and all, in this direct spin draw process, where spinning and drawing can be done at a time at a speeds up to 4000, due to some practical constraints we can go up to 4000 meters per minute. This is in case of spin draw process. But when it comes to high speed spinning process, you see, the spinning is carried out at 3000 to 4000 meters per minute to get partially oriented yarns, which we can also represent with POY. So spinning we are doing at 3000 to 4000 meters per minute, which leads to production of partially oriented yarn, to which a further draw up to 2, that is draw ratio. This is nothing but the draw ratio. So after spinning, we are going for drawing, we are maintaining a draw ratio of 2 up to 2 only, that may be less also, applied during sequential or simultaneous draw texturizing process. Texturizing is a process to impart the bulkiness with the filaments which resembles like the natural fibers. So at that process where we are imparting a draw ratio up to 2, but the spinning speeds we are maintaining at 3000 to 4000 meters per minute. So this is a high speed spinning process. And when it comes to super high speed spinning process, the spinning speeds at 4000 to 6000 meters per minute, understand, spinning speeds at 4000 to over 6000 meters per minute, okay, the filament spun at 5500 meters per minute, a further slight draw has still to be applied. That means even though we are producing or we are maintaining at this spinning speeds, a further drawing is required to get the complete orientation. So this is super high speed spinning. So till now we have discussed about what is this melt spinning and what is the need for melt spinning and in what way this is more advantageous than any other spinnings, and then we have seen the detailed elements in a melt spinning line including its functions, and also we have seen the spinning speeds, that is the range of spinning speeds right from conventional and direct spin draw process, high speed spinning and then super high speed spinning. Okay. This is what we have discussed till now. Okay. So now we are going to discuss in detail about each and every element which is present in the melt spinning line, right from extruder and then this manifold, gear pumps, filter and spinneret. These three things together we call it as spin pack assembly, and then quenching chamber, and then spin finish, and then drawing. All these things we will discuss in detail. So now we will discuss in detail about this extruder element. Okay. So if you look at this polymeric chips, that is, in the earlier days, the polymeric chips were melted by using heating grits. But now, extruders have completely replaced the other melting arrangements. So nowadays, so completely the melt spinning line is equipped with these extruders to carry out the melting process. Okay. The polymer is fed to spinning section in melted form directly from a continuous polymerization line. So as I told you already, so in case of polyester and nylon, whatever the after the polymerization process of, that is like from the monomers, the conversion of polymer, where it leads to a molten polymer. So that molten polymer, so one thing is directly we can feed to the spinning, like the gear pump, and like through this manifold we can feed it to different spinning lines. If not, suppose if the polymerization process leads to a solid polymer in case of polypropylene and polyethylene, where you can use this extruder to melt the polymeric chips, to melt the polymer chips. So now you can see here in this spinning line, that is melt spinning line, you can see clearly. So this is the hopper, we are feeding the polymeric chips, these are the polymeric chips, then it is coming to the extruder. This is what the extruder is. Now you see inside the extruder it is getting heated with the help of heating, that is oil. Okay. So inside it is heated, so that obviously the outside part also it gets heated. So whenever the polymeric chips come in contact with the outer surface, slowly it starts to melt. Finally it comes to the ending of the extruder, complete melting of polymer takes place. So then through manifold it is subjected to the gearing pump or spinning pump or melt pump, then filter, and finally spinneret. So here the quenching chamber, we are passing cool air, spin finish, and then drawing. So this is how the extruder, the, which is of screw type extruder, looks like, and how the melting is taking place. Okay, how the melting is taking place. Now, so apart from the melting of the polymeric chips, the extruder which is there, it homogenizes the melt by mixing at various stages. So I told you already, homogenization, that is each and every part of the molten polymer where the same sort of conditions will be, some sort of properties will be there, should have be there. Okay, so apart from melting the polymeric chips, the extruder homogenizes the melt by mixing at various stages. I will show you the different stages in the extruder. So the homogenization is an important aspect in order to ensure the continuous spinning without any breaks or non-uniformity of spun yarns. If there is no homogeneity in the polymer mix, where you can expect more number of end breakages. So the extruder compresses the polymer fluid to remove any untrapped gases, including air or nitrogen, that is drawn along with the chips as they enter into the hopper. So one thing is, it is melting the polymer, it is homogenizes the polymer melt, and then it removes any trapped gases like whatever this air or nitrogen at the time of feeding the polymeric chips. So now you can see here clearly. So what are the different elements in this? Sorry. So what are the different zones in the extruder? Now you see, this is the hopper. From the hopper, the polymeric chips are coming and it is contacting to the outer surface of the screw, that is the extruder. So inside the extruder there is a screw. This is called as the screw. Okay, then this screw is heated inside with the help of heating oils. Okay, now, so suppose the, based on the polymer, suppose if the polymer we are feeding, it is having melting point at 260 degrees Celsius, we are maintaining the inside, the screw temperature at 260 degrees Celsius. Now, if you look at, initially this is the feeding zone, that means all the polymeric chips, it will enter into the extruder region. And then here this is the melting zone, that means where the polymeric chips, when it is moving forward because of the rotation of the screw, okay, so where it is taking the polymeric chips forward, when it is moving forward, the polymeric chips will contact to the edges, that is the outer surface of the extruder, so it starts melting. And then here is the metering, that means it will allow the same quantity of the polymeric solution, that is molten polymer, to the next stage, that is mixing. So here molten polymer, so that means, so from here to here during its passage, where the polymeric chips are getting completely melted and then properly mixed at this stage. So that means in the extruder we have the zones like feeding, melting, metering, and then mixing. So we are feeding, the polymeric chips are melting, and when it is moving forward, where the same quantity is that is going to the next mixing stage, here it is getting properly mixed and then it is taken to the next level. Understand? So here one more thing you have to observe, that is the size of the screw. So you can see here, so it is like this. So here it is somewhat narrow, when it is moving, like, it is getting wider. So here, why it is narrow, in the sense we have to give some space for the polymeric chips to accommodate its space, place. And when it is moving forward, where the polymeric chips in its maximum surface, it will contact to the outer surface of the extruder. Maximum, it will contact with the outer surface, and there is no other way for the polymers. It has to contact and it has to melt. So that is why the shape of the screw is like this. This also one of the important thing you need to understand. And I told you it also helps in metering the flow rate in spinning line. Like same quantity it will send it to the next element. Okay, finally it acts as the polymeric fluid pump and it provides the necessary pressure that is required by the polymer to flow from the extruder to the metering pump. So from this extruder to the next level where it has to pump the molten polymer at some pressure. Understand? So here is also the same sort of diagram. And one thing you can see is, so the advantages of using this screw extruder is where higher melting rate will be there, like fast, and capacity is large, and greater homogenization we can achieve, and short resident time. That is, the presence of polymer inside the extruder is very, very short. And if you look at the screws, the diameter as 45 to 300 mm and melting capacity, you can see 50 to 2000 kgs per hour. And screw length is normally it lies between 28 to 33 times to its diameter. And barrel is heated along its length by oil or electricity. I was telling you, no? And polymer softened partially by conducted heat and partially by frictional heat developed by movement of the screw. So when the screw is moving, where it is slowly taking the polymers to the next, that is forward, during its forward direction, so it is getting contacted with the outer end of the screw and then it is getting melted. So here also you can see. So I wish to show you the like the arrangement of the screw. You can see the arrangement. So even in this diagram, you can much better understanding about this, how the extruder and what are the different zones. Now these are all the polymeric chips. This is the feeding region. That means all the polymers will feed, will accommodate its place. Maybe you see more space is there here. So here the space is, that is widened, that is screw shape is widened. Now when the screw is rotated, what is happening? It is taking all the polymeric chips to forward in this direction. Now you see this black and all you can observe. Now what is happening here? The polymeric chips, when it is moving forward, slowly it is getting melted. And finally you can see when it reaches here, complete melting is taking place. Complete melting. So this is the screw shaft. Inside it is getting heated with oil or electricity. This is the feeding zone. This is the melting zone. And this is the metering zone. So metering in the sense, it will flow, it will pass the uniform flow of the polymer melt to the next level. And here we have mixing will also will be there, complete mixing, and at some pressure it is pumping through the next elements. Here also the same thing again. Okay. Now the next one is manifold. Okay, this is also an important element, that is spinning manifold. So this will supply the molten polymer solution to different spinning elements, spinning lines. Okay, so whatever this manifold is there, the design and heating conditions of spinning manifold have a significant effect on filament quality. That is the heating conditions of the spinning manifold. Why? Because the important thing you need to note. So whatever the temperature we are melting the polymer at extruder, at the same temperature, that is the temperature of molten polymer solution need to be maintained same throughout the melt spinning process. That is up to spinner head. So from the extruder up to spinner head, so whatever the polymer melt is coming, that has to be in same temperature. So whatever the design and heating conditions of the manifold, which is having a significant effect on the filament quality. Therefore, it needs to be considered carefully. Why? Because through this manifold only, it will distribute to different spinning lines. So, the temperature and the design of the manifold is very, very important. Suppose if the manifold is unable to maintain the temperature of the molten polymer, what will happen if the temperature drops? Again, some part of polymer may convert to solid state. If over temperature is there also, again, it will give some kind of changes in the polymer properties. Okay. In a typical spinning unit, the polymer fluid may be conveyed from the last polycondensation vessel in case of direct spinning, like from the condensation vessel itself to the direct spinning line. So, in case of batch processing, continuous processing in the sense, from the polymerization vessel, directly the molten polymer is fed to spinning lines. There is no problem. When it comes to batch processing, where like the extruder through manifold. Okay. So, whatever these tubes that are there, which is heated by circulation of Dauthen, so which is a heating medium. Now, you can see, this is what the manifold melt spinning line. Okay. Whatever the polymer fluid is derived to number of spinnerets, each equipped with a spinning pump. So, through the manifold only, it will distribute through different spinning pumps. So, there are two important requirements of the manifold. First of all, the melt paths before reaching the spinneret orifice must be of exactly the same length. That is, this is what the important aspect in this manifold. That is the melt path. That is, so after coming out from the extruder, it will reaches to the, it will come to the manifold. From the manifold, it will distribute to the different spinning lines. So, whatever the path which is there for the spinneret 1, that should be same for the spinneret 5. So, accordingly, the design of the manifold should be there. Otherwise, what will happen? So, here it will reaches early, there it will reaches slowly. So, that path makes some kind of changes in the molten polymer. So that what will happen, even though same molten polymer we are taking from the extruder, the filaments which we are getting it from the different spinning lines is going to be varying. So this is the one of the important criteria, like the manifold length, that is the polymer melt length, should be same for all the melt, that is spinning things. And this, why it is required in the sense, to equalize the pressure and also which ensure that the same quantity of material reaches each orifice. So, one is to maintain the same pressure, and the second one is where same quantity is being fed to each spinning orifice. And the second one is the melt streams and the spinneret must have identical temperature profiles. So, through the manifold, the molten polymer is flowing, the temperature we are maintaining inside this manifold, that is we are maintaining in the manifold, that should be same as that of the temperature which we are maintaining in the spinneret. The identical temperature should be there to avoid the quality issues with the filaments. So, it is to ensure the melt homogeneity and uniform temperature profile. This is very important. Okay. So, these are the two things. So, while selecting the manifold, where the design consideration as well as the temperature profile, of the manifold is very, very important to maintain the required qualities in the final output of filaments. And after the manifold, where the molten polymer is fed to the spinning pump, or we can call it as a spin pack assemblies, spin pack assembly. If you look at the spin pack assembly, where we have a gearing pump, we have the filter, and then we have the spinneret. Okay, so the polymer melt is transported to spinneret through exact metering pump, that is gearing pump. It is used to maintain the exact amount of feed, and the pressure also, it is very important. Without any pressure, simply if you pour, do you think it will come out? It will not come out. So we are maintaining a pressure of 20 to 200 bar with deviation of plus or minus 3%. And filters, we are using, like we are using filter alumina and then metal screens. We are using in the filter as a filter medium. So what will happen after metering the exact quantity of molten polymer? It will pass through these filters, which is having sand, fine sand, alumina, and then metallic screens, metal screens, which will filter out any unwanted particles or unmolten polymers. All these things it will filter it out. Okay, now you can see here. So how this spin pack assembly looks like. Now you see here the polymer inlet. This is the polymer inlet. The entire thing is the spin pack assembly. Now you can see this is the spinning pump, which is nothing but the gearing pump. So which will flow the same quantity of which will pass same quantity of polymer melt through this spinneret. So here we have this filter pack will be there, and below which we have this spinneret. So through the spinneret we are passing the molten polymer at some pressure, 20 to 200 bar that can be varied, where the continuous filaments are coming out. So these are the insulation chambers, and then this is the yarn bundle. Okay, this is the pump drive. So gear pump, it needs some drive, na? So this pump is getting drive from here, polymer melt we are passing. So then the gears are rotating in between, the polymer melt is coming out, then it is feeding through the filter media, and then through spinneret we are producing continuous filament of yarns. And now if you look at spinneret, as you already know, the spinneret also called as, that is the spelling the same thing, which is a small thin thimble shaped metal nozzle having fine holes. Okay, the viscous solution prepared by melting the raw polymers so emerges from the spinneret as a long fibers. Now you can see how the holes are there in the spinneret. Here also you can see how the filaments that are coming out. Okay, so most spinnerets are made out of the stainless steel, but rayon production requires platinum, where some considerations are there that I'll explain you later. The size and shape of the spinneret hole determines the filament cross sectional shape. So since we are producing these fibers or filaments, so depending upon the required cross sections we can produce the filaments. So by simply changing the cross section of hole in the spinneret, so each hole forms a single filament, and the combined filaments form the filament yarn. So we are combining all the filaments and we are producing a single yarn. Now you can see there how the filament, that is how the spinneret and holes that are looks like. Okay, so if you look at this spin pack and spinneret, where the spinneret is made out of stainless steel and platinum, the thickness is 3 to 30 mm. The hole dia, if you look at this, 100 to 500 micrometers, and different arrangement of holes like concentric circles, parallel rows, scatter patterns like that, and the number of holes vary from 2,4 to 60,000. So depending upon the what denier we want and the number of filaments in the yarn where we will be choosing the required spinneret and its cross section.
Okay.
And after the spinneret, once the filament passes through the spinneret, so what is happening? Where continuous filaments are coming out. So now, soon after the continuous filaments are coming out from the spinneret, still the filament are in its molten state only. So what we have to do? We have to convert the molten state again into solid state so that we can easily wind it on two bobbins conveniently. Otherwise, what will happen? The filaments may stick to each other or it may stick to any other roller surface because of its molten state. So the process of doing this conversion from molten state to solid state again, which we call it as quenching process. Or the system we are using is the cooling system only. Simply we are passing cool air. If you look at this quenching, there are three different ways. One is cross flow quenching. That means the filaments are coming out like this and we are passing the cool air. This is called as cross flow quenching. And the second one is inflow quenching. That means the filaments are coming out. That means the filaments are coming out and we are passing cool air like this. This is inflow. Okay. Sorry, this is outflow. Inflow in the sense, we are passing like this. We are passing through the filaments. Okay. We are passing the cool air through the filaments, inside to outside. Okay. Now when it comes to the last one, that is outflow quench, that means the filaments that are coming out, that means from outside to inside, we are passing the cool air. This is called as outflow quench. So in case of cross flow quench, where the filaments are coming out like this and we are passing the cool air like this. Understand? That is, in case of inflow quench, we are passing, that is, once the filaments are coming out, so where from inside to outside, we are passing the cool air so that quenching takes place. So out of all these three, so cross flow quench is more effective in getting the solidification of filaments within short time. Understand? So again, those things only. You can see here, this is how the cross flow quenching will be there. You can see this is the spinneret. That is, sorry, this is spinneret. This is the quenching chamber. Now you see how the hot, that is cool air is passed. This is the air wall, cool air is passing through like this. This is called as cross flow quenching. Once the quenching is completed, then it is taken out. You can see the cross section, these are the filaments and this air will blow through the filaments. Okay. This is cross flow and this is inflow quench. You can see here where soon after the production of filaments, we are passing the cool air inside to outside. So we are passing, see how we are passing and all. We are passing from, so inside to, that is inside we are passing. So inside to outside. This is inflow quench. And then finally, you can see here, inside and finally, outflow quenching. So it is used for filament yarns of high denier and for spinning of staple fibers. So in this system, much air can be blown uniformly through a bundle of many densely arranged filaments. Okay. So for this type of quench, large spinneret diameters and distance between spinnerets are necessary than for first two methods. Thus, a spinneret selection also should be very important. You can see here outflow from inside to out. Okay, inflow in the sense, so the flow is going to be inside, and outflow in the sense the airflow is going to inside to outside. So sorry, it was by mistake I told you that. In case of outflow quench, you see from inside to outside we are passing. Outside the air is coming out. In case of inflow quench, you see that is outflow. Inside to outside the air is going out. In case of inflow, where from outside to inside the air we are blowing. In case of crass, against the filaments just we are passing it. So that is it. So whatever the quenching system it is there, it is comprised of turbulent air streams, but the degree of turbulence is kept to a minimum of production of uniform filament yarns. Okay. So finally, we are applying the spin finish. Already you know. So why we are applying the spin finish? It is a temporary finish to impart the lubrication and then to reduce to impart lubrication so that the friction is going to be minimized. And finally, where the static charges present in the filament is going to be prevented in the next process. Okay. And finally, after finishing spin finish, where we have a drawing rollers will be there, where the filament is going to be stretched as per the required draw ratio, then it is winding onto a winding device. If you look at the take up device, it is sliced horizontally and below the appropriate spinneret. Each and every spinneret is having its own winding unit, and to attain the uniform speeds, the tube roll is a friction driven by other. That is the bobbin, it is placed on a, that is in frictional contact with the winding roll. Okay, so this ensures that the requirement of constant take up speeds is compiled with when the diameter of wrap increases. So with respect to increasing the diameter, where the take up speeds are going to adjust. This is what the thing is. This is the bobbin. Okay, this is the bobbin and the yarn which is coming out, and it is winded on to the bobbin. Okay, so this is all about the different elements in the melt spinning line and function of each and every element, right from hopper to extruder, manifold and spin pack assembly, where it consists of gear pump, filter and then spinneret, then quenching chamber. We have crass flow, inflow and outflow. Crass flow in the sense the filaments are coming out, where against the filaments we are passing the cool air. In case of inflow quench, where from the outside we are passing inside, we are passing the cool air inside. And in case of outflow quench, from inside, in case of inflow quench, from outside to inside we are passing. In case of outflow, inside to outside we are passing the cool air. Once the quenching is completed, the filament converts to its solid state. Then we have this, what we call it as. Then we have this spin finish application to prevent the generation of static charges. Then we are stretching the filaments according to the required spin draw ratios. And then we are winding on to take up device. That is winding on to bobbin. Okay, so by means of friction driven rollers. So this is all about the melt spinning line. So hope you understand this class. In the next class, we will discuss in detail about what are the different process variables. What are the different process variables that affects the melt spun yarn quality. So this thing we will discuss in detail in next class. Thank you.